Why making this film?
What bothers you that makes you make the film?
I wonder if I had gotten it all wrong. My own sense of politics, of life, of where things were going to go in my lifetime. And I start to feel terribly disappointed with my generation and the sense of the kind of politics that we have had in the last 10 years or for some time. I start to feel that so many of us are not in the present or reaching to the future or living in the moment that's becoming, and we're missing the moment and we don't know how to read the moment. I only want to put forward certain things that people are thinking about and ways that people are thinking about the world. The film, in a sense, is like a conversation. It's a conversation, you know, it's a pairing of people and a multiplicity of voices, you know, from academia, historians, sociologists, technologists, technology history, and put them into a conversation. And there are people from all over the world that we've spoken to. I'm interested in the state of the world and political thought and how we're giving description to the world from various kinds of disciplines and different modes of thinking. So let's see if we could start talking to some people. And through these conversations, I wanted to give description to how we've arrived at this moment, what's in front of us, and the moment that we're living in.
We were talking about technology in general and the effects it's likely to have on society and the problems related to technological transplanting of technology and technology into underdeveloped countries. In regard to this problem of the ultimate revolution.
What's happening right now is really a radical shift leading to a world that's entirely unlike what we had 20 years ago, and in many ways unlike anything that's ever been part of human society. I think it's really crucial to rethink where we're at.
I think no meaning, no condition, no institution is permanently settled. This is a time of unsettlement. We don't know anymore exactly what it means. What does the national mean? We are even beginning to have a critical stance towards this notion of the global.
What we are experiencing right now is not just the collapse of certain systems, but a crisis or even a collapse of the notion of system itself. This whole fiction that we have self-organizing systems, which was at work in all kinds of areas of society. There is a lack of people asking, well, what is a system? You know, maybe the system is another God delusion of our time.
We all believe that we can be at the center of our own network effects and that the benefits of scale can accrue to us. I mean, it's not even a question just of wealth anymore. It's a question of believing that you can be at the center of the network. You can be a winner versus a loser. We believe we can be Kim Kardashian. We believe we could go to Harvard, and we could believe we could be Mark Zuckerberg, because those examples are real. We are not individuals anymore. We are brands.
Imagining a different world, in that sense, just seems like folly. How can you possibly challenge forms of domination? It's way easier to imagine the end of the world than it is to imagine the end of the current order. And then we got all these, you know, films about the end of the world because the end of capitalism, for instance, you know, forget it. You can't even imagine it.
The environmental crisis, or the climate crisis, has revealed this secondary, more insidious crisis, this crisis of agency. We don't know what to do. I'm not talking about people in dire poverty. I'm talking about, you know, us. What do we do?
I think that there is a great deal of writing about what's happening today, but so much of it is uncritical, tending towards very pat explanations rather than really engaging with what's happening now. I think that we've lost our ability to think of ourselves historically. I think we need to ask very deep questions about the present day. You know, Jean Baudrillard talked about the millennium as being the end of the end of history. He talked about how already in the 90s, there was so much information, there were so many events that we could no longer meter ourselves. We have lost our ability to think of ourselves in time. The last decade is a perfect example. You know, the 2000s, I just gave it a name of the 2000s, but that's not really what we call it. You know, we don't call it there have been names like the aughts, the O's, the zeros, but it isn't like the 90s. It isn't like the 80s, the 70s, or the 60s. There's no real sense of the decade. What was it? There's also no sense, I think, of where we are today. We don't talk about ourselves historically. We talk about the radical changes that are happening, but we don't ask how we got here very much. It was very useful for people to understand where they were in a kind of broader historical continuum and not just think that the world was just apparent and came fully blown. And by losing our ability to sequence, by losing our ability to think historically, I think we've become even more unmoored than we already were. And I think this is very dangerous. I think we accept the world around us as very natural. We also accept it as eternal and unchanging. One of the many ways to analyze the present, and to me the most effective way, is to try and understand it historically. And try and understand that the way that we figure ourselves historically in a broader historical lens.
Humanity spent millions of years being hunter-gatherers in tribes, at most 70 people strong, and they move a lot because they know a lot about different nuts and berries and roots and so on, and they move in search for food. They are much more adaptable than agriculturalists precisely because they don't depend on a single harvest. When hunter-gatherers first discovered agriculture and settled down in Mesopotamia and Egypt, they did not look at agriculture and go, oh my God, that's progress. We would like to be like you people. They had to be forced to be agriculturalists. Why? Because there were not improvements of a hunter-gatherer lifestyle. Humanity surrounds itself with mud, brick houses, and stone walls and stone temples in the original cities in Mesopotamia and Egypt. And now the regulations were much more strict. You were regulated by caste or by class, and you had to dress in certain ways depending on where you were. Everything was more regulated.
The idea that society is not natural, as the Aristotelians and the theologians would all maintain, human beings are not what Aristotle called a zoa politica, that's to say, human creatures made for life in the polis. They are actually, they start as wandering bands, hence the myth of the state of nature which emerges, and they come together in order to protect themselves. In order to secure longer and happier lives for themselves, they make a pact with each other. that I surrender to you my absolute rights in nature on condition that you surrender the same to me, and we come together and we form civil societies. Civil societies are essentially means of protection. Protection against each other and protection against the outside world. As Aristotle says, outside the city only beasts and heroes can live.
Henri Lefebvre was a key French philosopher who analyzed space and analyzed urban life in, I think, very intelligent ways. And he talked about the right to the city as being something that we all should have. That is, we all should have the right to transform the city and in so doing transform ourselves. And I think by that, he meant we wanted the city to become a place that was a better place for all of us to live, a place in which there would be a diversity of class, access for people in all walks of life to decent shelter, to decent schools, food that wouldn't make you sick, to health care, and to the possibilities of the city, to the city as being a place in which you could better yourself in every way, you know, become a better person, have a better work environment, have a better everyday life.
We have these old cities that are the witnesses, Rome, Istanbul, they're still there. The cities have outlived all these other power systems because they are complex and incomplete.
People flock to cities, they always have flocked to cities as a way of increasing their expectations for life. And cities have grown larger and larger. The great Scottish philosopher David Hume said on his deathbed, shortly before the American Revolution, that what he hoped to see were two things, the cutting of London by half and the liberation of the American colonies. And so, you know, you have this idea that somehow the city is some kind of corrupting force.
Remember, we didn't invent the city. Ants have cities. Termites have cities. Termites have cities with 2 million to 20 million individuals. Bees live in small towns, 20,000 to 150,000 bees. We did not come up with these big social agglomerations. And bacteria, our foremothers, our founding foremothers, the founding foremothers of life itself, live in groups of 7 trillion. That's more in one city, in one megalopolis, than all the humans who have ever lived. So this business of getting together and thriving, hey, this has been around since the beginning of life.
Anytime a city is born, it's born as a function of the state of the art of transportation at that moment. So in ancient Athens, you know, you had a city that was built for foot, and then you had, you know, later cities built by the docks and cities built for horses, and eventually, you know, the railroad cities of Chicago, and you had, you know, the sort of automotive cities, you know, all of which Los Angeles is the template. And you know, the function of each of these things is that the shape of the city changed and expanded in relation to the technology. So, you know, so for example, if you go to Athens, I mean, Athens is a city, ancient Athens is a city about 6 miles wide. You could walk from the center to the edge in, you know, 3 miles out and then walk back. And what's interesting is that it took about 30 minutes to walk to the edge and back. And then when you changed to horses, you know, when you rode horses, the cities also grew to about, you know, 30 minutes out and back. The commute didn't change. The amount of time we're willing to spend traveling has never changed. I mean, an Italian physicist named Cesare Marchetti did the research on this and coined Marchetti's constant. You know, 60 minutes daily is basically our tolerance for travel. And what this did, though, is as the technology changed, cities exploded in size. And to me, what's interesting is that, you know, that, you know, daily commutes are one thing, but the scope of human action, how we decide how we can interact over distances, has changed as well. And so this, you know, there's been an evolution basically from, you know, from a purely local economy of Athens to, you know, a city economy, to a regional economy, to nations, to now we interact globally.
We can classify cities in two different categories. Landlocked capitals, like Madrid, Paris, Vienna, Berlin, Mexico City, Washington, Peking, and maritime ports like Venice, when Venice was Venice, Genoa, Lisbon, Amsterdam, Antwerp, Shanghai, New York. When you look at the history of these two cities, the spaces they inhabit, they are, of course, embodied entities with, you know, they need food to come in to feed their people. They have epidemic diseases that come in. They are subject to biology, chemistry, physics. They're embodied, and they are also specially situated, but their spaces are very different. In the case of landlocked capitals, what you have is typically the organization of a region by the regional capital connected to smaller towns. They distill a regional culture, bringing influence from all over the region. That way, the region acquires a very well-defined identity, a embodied and spatially situated identity, though. Maritime ports, on the other hand, have never created a regional culture. For one thing, they are engaged in long-distance trade with foreign cultures, which means that they have to speak very different languages, and they don't have time to be distilling their own regional identity. These cities tend to develop a hybrid culture. You know, Amsterdam, Lisbon, Venice, New York, they don't even have a language, for God's sakes. Globalization was born when these cities' maritime ports began forming networks among one another. By the 17th century, when Amsterdam was the center of the network, they had already become global. Amsterdam had connections to New York, had connections to Indochina, had connections all over the place.
The 30 Years' War is a significant moment in European history because it's the last great conflict between religious parties, or at least it's ideologically driven by religion. The Treaty of Westphalia of 1648 establishes effectively the nation state as the crucial political unit for the following centuries. And it is also a war fought globally, if you include the Dutch war against the Spanish in that as well, which plays a part into it. The Dutch were involved in the 30 Years' War, so the war is being fought also in the East Indies. It's being fought in the Americas. This is a war that's fought all the way from Pomerania to India, from Northern Europe to Southern India. From that moment, really, the world becomes a globalized unit.
The nation states cannot act as sovereign powers now, economically, politically, even culturally, and that rather, in some sense above the nation states or in a much larger network with the nation states, is forming a new kind of sovereignty, a new form of order. And that, I guess we could, so, and this is what we're calling empire, this network of unequal powers.
We know that there is an enormous amount of change. No formal system of power has lasted forever.
In fact, at some point, the evidence is with every species, things can and do end. And that is true of countries. So 3/4 of the flags of the United Nations were not there 75 years ago. Countries appear and disappear with regular frequency. And that's rich countries and poor countries. You've tripled the number of borders, flags, and anthems in Europe, in Africa, in Asia over the last 75 years.
I Ask yourself, how do formalized systems of power come down? They usually do not come down due to a superior force. That's very important. That was the case, the iconic case, World War II and World War I, where superior military force brought the system down. But look at the Soviet Union. It was not our superior anything that brought it down. The military dictatorships in Latin America, it was not a superior military force. Apartheid in South Africa, it was not a superior military force. Eastern and Central Europe, it was not a superior military force. So the question then is, how does change come about? The great philosopher of liberal democracy, of course, is Locke, who is really the narrator in his time of the emergence of this new actor, subject, which has the right to own property, not just property, means of production. This is the rise of the bourgeoisie. The bourgeois subject is a subject that is the subject of liberal democracy, enacts the liberal democratic project. And I would say the middle classes do that in the Keynesian decades, you know, in the 1940s, 50s. The decades of mass production, mass consumption, mass suburbanization. And the historic subject who enacts that project is the middle class. The project of the middle class that begins, you know, in the 1940s in this country and in Western Europe was that every generation does a little better. And out of that came a sense that this is good, it functions, the system rewards education, it rewards. And now we have the other side of the curve.
The 60s were certainly a kind of transformative moment in our culture, and one of the things that happened was certainly kind of the critique by the New Left of the idea of the modernist plan and the idea of big government. It didn't just come from the New Left, it also came from the right. And that's where we see this kind of, let's say, unholy alliance, if you will. The New Left set out against a world of big government that, in their view, had been co-opted by capitalism. They tried to balance Nietzsche and Marx, let's say the individual with the greater good. And, you know, they weren't just arguing against Western governments, they were also having a great deal of issues with the kind of centrally planned governments of the communist powers. And seeing this kind of big planning, this kind of top-down planning has failed, and we're trying to come up with more bottom-up methods, with methods in which the world would be, in which we would be able to participate in decision-making processes. And this aligned itself up rather neatly with a kind of growing right-wing critique that came out of, let's say, kind of the Austrian / Chicago school of neoliberal economists that began with people like Hayek and Schumpeter, and later on, of course, people like Friedman. And this group then argued against government, period. They argued for a libertarian view of society in which government would sort of wither away and play a kind of minimal role.
I think we do need new concepts, you know, new ways of thinking about what is a profoundly new reality. One way that Tony Negri, my co-author, and I were thinking as we were starting to write this book, Empire, was about a sort of historical coincidence perceived from a number of disciplines. Economists were recognizing that, you know, sometime between 1968 and 1973, that the factory production and factory labor is no longer dominant in the dominant countries is being exported. Then other economists sort of recognizing that a certain regime of accumulation is shifting in those same years. In literary studies and art studies, a move from so-called modernist aesthetics to postmodernist aesthetics. In political regimes, the end of the colonial era, a movement towards a post-colonial through national liberation struggles. We thought all these different disciplines are recognizing a shift more or less in the same years, let's say 68 to 73, something like that. What if we would consider them all like, you know that story of the blind man and the elephant? The economists are feeling it feels like a trunk, and the sociologists are feeling this, and the literary critics, you know, feel like this. What if we try to put them all together and try to recognize what is this historical world shift that happened more or less in these years? So one way of our trying to grasp this shift is in by hypothesizing, in a way, the end of imperialism as the model of global control, imperialism as the model of formation of a global order.
if we see ourselves as heirs of the Enlightenment, with all of its declarations of natural rights, universal rights, and common goods, we are also the heirs of the imperial worlds of domination and violence that Europeans in the same era constructed, the same era as the Enlightenment. I think this complex model of reflective global citizenship that doesn't jettison all notions of universalism, but doesn't simply avoid the fact that these legacies are politically and morally complex. In other words, all these universalisms are potentially fallible, but I think one simple historical test that we could apply is what has been the legacy of the enunciation of these universalisms? Has it been relatively progressive or regressive?
Everything you see around, we're going to basically double it in 2 decades. An unfathomable idea. You can build bottom-up and you can get informal settlements in favelas, but it also increases the temptation of governments to basically build now and build whatever you have handy because you need to house these people and feed them and clothe them. And so, you know, to me it's a notion of like Le Corbusier stalked his ghost has slipped back into the room here. There's greater temptation than ever by the state to actually build. And this is why we see, you know, China building the equivalent of Rome every 2 weeks, why India needs the equivalent of a new Chicago every year, is because there's a race. There's a race to basically solve the sort of, you know, on one side, you know, massive pools of finance that need to be invested, but then also sort of global youth glut. I mean, this is why we have revolutions in the Arab world, is there's basically a generation of young people who feel superfluous. And that, you know, that could be the ultimate sort of, you know, thing in this, is that basically, you know, is that we're seeing the planner step into this to sort of solve this dilemma of too many people, too much money, and too little time. That's ultimately where the planner steps back in. It's not that the planner knows best. It's not that it's the genius culture. It's that there simply is no time. We need someone to make the decision and simply to implement it. And that, to me, and that's where mistakes are made, as soon as you reach that moment where we have to build now. But yet, you know, people are willing to make them.
We've created an environment that is radically different from anything that's ever been on the planet before. So we can talk about this as being the Anthropocene, and period. And by that, I mean the planet is being shaped by human intention and action. It's not some background, it's not some kind of quote physical process or geologic process. It is human constructs that's changing the geology and the nature of the planet and life. And that means we have a very different notion of what human nature is than it was, say, in the Enlightenment. We're making a transition from an Enlightenment worldview, mechanical, reductionist, subject-object kind of world, to one that is highly dynamic, that has a different, basically, ontology of what reality is. Our notion of physics is very different. Our notion of what can be known and how well things can be known are being changed. We're really understanding the neuroscience, the evolutionary biology, and we're inventing life for ourselves. We're constructing it, sometimes with intention, sometimes with not.
The difference between a human being and a monkey is about 1% of gene code. The real difference is maybe whales sing, maybe dolphins have a language, maybe dogs learn commands, maybe parrots learn words. But very few animals, in fact, only one animal on Earth, teaches its great-great-grandchildren stuff systematically across time. And the way we do that is we start drawing on cave walls, which is something no other animal has ever done. And it's civilizations from long ago teaching us stuff across time. This is how you make fire. This is how you hunt animals. This is how you cook them. This is how you dress with them. We get more and more efficient at this. All of a sudden, we can do it so that we can use hieroglyphs. We can use stylized Chinese characters. But eventually what we have to do is there's so much knowledge that we have to simplify that into a 26-letter alphabet in English, 29 letters in Spanish. We have to put it on movable type. We have to build big printing presses. And all of a sudden, instead of having one cave wall, instead of having a few hieroglyphs on papyrus or clay tablets, you now have thousands and then millions and then tens of millions of books. And that's how we learned until about 30 years ago. What's happened over the last 30 years is we've changed the code we read and write in, the code we listen to music in, the code we take pictures in, the code that we use video or movies in, and collapsed it into a two-letter alphabet. You want to talk about how empires appear and disappear? It's people who adapt and adopt to new codes.
Your ability to move through space and interact with people is purely dependent on technology and dependent on technology shrinking the amount of times. Marx in The Annihilation of Space by Time, he was thinking about industrial economies and industrial transportation. What the internet has done, what telecommunications has done, is basically given us the illusion that we are living simultaneously. I mean, we basically have simultaneous electronic access to anyone or anything, or so we think.
Or are we talking about a disjuncture, a break in the system? It's a new condition. We shouldn't just call it with the same old words.
In 1844, the first year of the commercial telegraph, Kierkegaard published a book called The Concept of Grid. He was quite aware that a new environment had formed around the old mechanical one. And whenever a new environment goes around an old one, there's always new terror. We live in a time when we have put a man-made satellite environment around the planet. The planet is no longer nature. It's no longer the external world. It's now the content of an artwork. The planet, nature has ceased to exist.
Well, I think you're anticipating a century, perhaps.
When you put a man-made environment around the planet, you have, in a sense, abolished nature. Nature from now on has to be programmed.
In Heidegger's philosophy of technology, you have the idea that technology is not something socially produced, it's not a social construction, but it is something where humans have no agency. It is something like an ontological fact. The nuclear bomb, what Heidegger was reacting to in his later philosophy, is an ontological effect. It's a fact of being, and we have to deal with it. Yeah, it's a kind of technological existentialism, really.
It's really easy to fall into a nostalgia trap around technology. You know, there's this thing called the human, and then there's this other thing called technology that comes later. Technology is this prosthetic, and it extends our senses, as McLuhan said. It's not about human good, technology bad. Techne is just craft or art or technique, right? And human beings have always had a relationship to craft and art and technique since the very beginning. Whether it's how you hold a pencil or cultivate plants and food and things like that.
The conditions and capacities learned in one system affect, influence, and shape the being in another. The technological and the sociological have come together so that they are so intertwined that you cannot distinguish one from the other.
If you say postmodernism was about refusal of a grand narrative, it also meant it was a refusal of the bigger picture. And now we are haunted by the bigger picture.
A lot of people describe postmodernity, the period after World War II and through the 1960s and 1970s, as a transition out of hierarchy and pyramid-shaped organization into flexible, flat, cellular, you might say kind of rhizomatic organization. One of the characteristics of a more centralized, hierarchical, pyramid-shaped system is that quite often power flows unidirectionally from the person wielding power out to either the bottom of the pyramid or the periphery of the hub and spoke wheel, if you will. But these flatter systems elevate the status of the individual node, right? So individuals in society are kind of granted more individuality. All of our interests and desires are catered to. With more flexible, flat, rhizomatic networks, which are often called distributed networks, you have much more allowance given for interactivity. What's interesting is that in order for that to happen, you have to have a heavily managed and codified interface. So people now have interfaces. You have to have a profile if you're on a social networking site.
Well, I literally wake up and pick up my phone and check Twitter is the first thing I do. I've been conditioned by that. And I've been conditioned to read Twitter because I want to see what happened in the Middle East and China overnight by other individuals. The scale of individual thought has changed, where instead of reading the New York Times first thing in the morning, I'm actually listening to individuals on the other side of the world.
I was very hopeful that people would kind of go through the wormhole and move from passive consumption of media, ideas, messaging, religion, drugs, everything, to active participation, that we would get our hands on the dashboard of civilization, I used to say, you know. As the internet actually unfolded, it became much more about commerce than I imagined. So people ended up using these technologies to amplify the role of the market in our affairs.
Internet culture has shown that new conglomerates have only come up because they understood how to valorize, how to exploit, how to make use of, you know, active involvement of a massive amount of users.
Open source coders and open source filmmakers, and then the big entities are going to come in and exploit our labor, our free labor.
You have literally hundreds of thousands and millions of web users who are performing essentially lots of unpaid volunteer micro labor online. That gets monetized by Web 2.0 companies.
Network culture is dominated, on the one hand, by technology and by the kind of connections that networks have made possible for us. So it's different than the digital moment. It's not about the heavy computer that's isolated and an individual sits in front of, but it's rather a world of light mobile technologies like notebook computers that are connected up via an invisible amorphous and even unknowable entity, you know, the internet. And it's that, but it's also a world in which the network has become a kind of dominant metaphor and model for society, for corporations, for economies, and even for individuals.
Everyone embracing the network as what's new. This is what's new. Now we understand stuff. As if saying it's the network is some sort of explanatory gesture, right? what I find fascinating about networks is I actually think it's a response to the postmodern confusion, right? Individuals are placed in situations which they can't understand because it's beyond their conception, right? And so as they're saying this, what's emerging is the science of the network as precisely a way of placing oneself within these larger structures, right? And so it's a scaling device. What's fascinating is at what point do people believe they're part of a network? What is the sort of affective connection that is in place for something like this to emerge?
The difficulty is that we can be trapped by our metaphors. We can be trapped by our concepts. We can be trapped by the limitations of the material realities we're capable of turning into metaphor. And the network is a perfect example of that. We network metaphors infuse our time. They're what we see through. We've all grown up with the internet. We've all grown up with the World Wide Web. We think that we can understand the world through World Wide Webbing. But there's a big problem with the metaphor of the network. The network is very unhierarchical. The network has hubs, and they have lots of connections, and then they have lots of individuals who are a lot less connected that are outliers of the hubs. But that's not the way the world works. Networks do not deal with emergent properties. And until we deal with emergent properties, we're not going to have a clue as to what the real creative fountainhead of this cosmos is really all about.
We only see a very small part of what's going on, right? You know, packet sniffer, you can see so much on, blah, blah, blah. But what if all of a sudden, rather than having everything masked with these computers, we took seriously the massive amount of interactions that are happening around us all the time? Wouldn't that change how we understand what our network is and how we interact with it?
What is the ontology of networks in general? It's not so much the kind of stability or equilibrium of an ecosystem or a network. It's actually the moment when a system is kind of compromised, or when, in the parlance of hackers, when an exploit is discovered. And once you do that, you've essentially created a new network, right? Because now you are a node in a new relationship. And so it's really that dynamic of networks being changed by virtue of being almost kind of infected or attacked from different external sources. And it seems like that kind of dynamic of antagonism is in fact much more part of what networks are all about.
Now people are grappling with this idea of networks, which is radically different in terms of presumptions and intuitions than hierarchical managerial organizations. The presumption of a hierarchical structure is that there's somebody at the top and there's a nice little set of strata and there's someone at the bottom. The typical network diagram, the graph, which comes from graph theory, where we draw lines between the nodes, the thing that people recognize as a network, is an impoverished and really, I think, obfuscating representation that doesn't expose the dynamic qualities of networks, because they are complex, they have no centers, they have, you know, no edges, they are always being reformulated, they're adaptive, they're flexible, they're, you know, so being able to kind of put a frame around it and say this is the center, or this is the most connected person, or this is the hub, or, you know, is a lie, right? Because the very property of network is that they're dynamic and adaptive and robust and resilient. And the internet, of course, being the thing that people are forced to think about networks with. We're confronted with complex, irreducibly complex network systems that we have to deal with.
The network gives you allegedly an apparatus, a way of understanding, a resolution, a scalability that allegedly allows you to have the knowledge in order to navigate, to map, to negotiate. But then my question is, we're all mapping, but we don't seem to know anymore. In other words, our condition doesn't seem to be that we can't map, but we're always producing maps. But what does that mean? Where does that get us?
Over time, we've been wrestling between adopting some system or map or way of understanding things that lets us feel so secure or safe or something that we surrender the sort of ongoing human project in making meaning and evolving and doing whatever it is we do. I look at there being this natural impulse to retreat into a system. Of course, many different forces would love us to retreat into a system, particularly if it's their system. And our occasionally our inability to distinguish between one of those systems and terra firma and reality. An important way of seeing the human expedition is to understand the ways that people tend to mistake maps for reality.
The question of networks, which is least understood, is the question of its scalability. The question of how, you know, networks can start off very, very small, even with an idea, with a concept, with a certain algorithm, and then scale up, and then a few years from then it's turned into an empire of incredible richness and power. We have to go back to the work of Paul Virilio about the politics of speed, because this is what really happens there. If we go electronic, if we start using the computer, we are suddenly in an environment which is incredibly fast. Even though we're not always catching up, still this is the condition in which we find ourselves. All these valuable experiences, they tend to break up so easily. So there is a strong urge for us to keep that momentum, knowing that it can disappear almost overnight. And this is unbearable. This is the unbearable lightness, of being electronic.
Network culture promises the possibility for everything, promises liberation for being able to work your way back through the network to trace, to gain access to anything you want. But in doing so, it's a bit of a myth. And we don't have that. We aren't able to fully realize ourselves as individuals because we aren't able to come together in any kind of greater entities. We aren't able to map the network. We aren't able to think of ourselves within a larger collectivity. The network publics we have are oriented around consumption, they're oriented around lifestyle, they're oriented around very small, generally non-political positions, as opposed to a broader public in which we could all participate in.
If communities, organizations, cities, countries affect subjectivity, they affect it mostly through the way in which they contribute to the forming of a public persona. Our private selves, I would argue, are mostly biological. There's a continuity between a human self conceived in terms of intensities and the selves of mammals like chimpanzees, dogs, dolphins, cats, and so on, and even smaller forms of being. That was a Humean conception. There's a continuity between animal and human perception. There's not a sharp discontinuity that's provoked by language, that's provoked by linguistic categories. And once you get rid of the idea of society as a whole, and you begin thinking in terms of concrete embodied entities that are made out of smaller entities, society becomes, of course, very complex.
You actually have to look at the level of the totality, at the level of the infrastructure, in order to understand the forces of power and relationships, rather than the individual. You know, we love to have these kind of hero narratives around subjects and individuals. I'm all for that to a certain extent. But I do think that we shouldn't kid ourselves about the way in which systems themselves actually have affect and agency.
Agency is the notion of that you basically control your own actions, your own fate. You have agency. You have the ability to act within a system and change the system. You know, and then there's the notion of structure. The system is basically unchanging. The system is more important. The system rearranges the individual to the system. I mean, these are sort of the tensions here.
It all comes back to what the great French essayist Montaigne, who's in the late 16th century, says, what is properly mine, right? This is where I begin. I begin with the I.
As I see it, the individual is a sham. It's a fiction, right? The individual was created.
The community is about the I transforming to a we. Hmm. A network is about you and all of you. You is both singular and plural.
Think of ourselves as individuals all the way down to this day, the less of a commons we have.
Commons has to do with the histories of property and ownership, and communally owned places of participation. The minute you call something a community, what you're really pointing out to is the boundaries, is the rights of access, about who gets access to the resources that the community has, who gets access to the commons that the community gates, and who are the people who are kind of kept outside of it. But when you look at the colonial history of the commons, for example, it was an administrative term which allowed for colonial masters to take over what was public and communally owned and turned it into a regulatory mechanism.
You can't make a capitalist fortune out of a common good. This notion of the public as something that originally emerges in the 18th century as being outside of government, but in a sense also outside of the interests of private capital, so that if there were ethical concerns to do with science or technology, there would be a place to talk about these things that isn't bought and paid for by the private capital interest that is driving a certain science or technology that may be harmful. How do we generate voices that are not the voices of corporations, that are not the voices simply of money-making entities whose responsibility is to their shareholders? We need to preserve a public voice.
Comfortable doing things that they can then take away. The idea of a personal computer is a huge oxymoron. But is there a way we can open it up and try to understand everything here that even our bodies are reacting to, even but we can't quite signal process, as a different kind of space or a public or an opening, a wounding from which something like agency and collective action can emerge.
Occupy Wall Street is a form of direct democracy. The way direct democracy works is it is everyone is heard, no voice above another. We bring people together and we discuss important decisions, discuss important topics, and everyone gets a chance to speak and everyone gets to be heard.
I'm trying to reveal this multiple form of power. If you understood power as we did previously, and as in many ways it functioned for much of the modern period, as having a center, having a sovereign instance, then you know how to resist it. You know conceptually and politically how to resist it. The czars in the Winter Palace, how do you make revolution? You go to St. Petersburg, you storm the Winter Palace. I mean, it might be hard, but conceptually, it's easy. If instead you accept that we're entering an era in which there is a dispersed and internally hierarchical, but nonetheless powerful and functional power that has no center, what the heck do you do? How do you attack it?
I think the idea of the multitude is helpful in that it's really not about a single quality, a single adjective, a single thing that binds everybody together. You know, so the working class, is the aggregation of all of the people who have nothing, who own nothing except their own labor power, right? But the multitude, I think, says something really different, which almost instead of operating in an additive way by saying we are this and we are this and we are this, it almost operates in a subtractive way. And it says we are together by virtue of a kind of very low-level generic commonality. It's really a kind of humanism, in fact. But not so much a kind of inflationary humanism, but almost a deflationary humanism, right? We are common by virtue of the fact that we have nothing in common.
If all technologies were about producing an intelligible future, saying that I will endure the precarity of the present because I will have a promissory note of the future of a certain kind, then this is what the digital is actually doing as well. This is what the digital is actually doing is that it's producing precarious presents and unsure futures. People who can no longer imagine their futures are coming onto streets and demanding their presents. The state in itself can no longer suffice as a promissory note of the future. My being a citizen does not mean anything. I might belong to the greatest economic superpower in the world right now, but it doesn't mean anything. On the other hand, you have the market, you have overproduction, but then you have underproduction of consumers. So that you're producing more goods, but on the other hand, you're producing fewer and fewer people who can afford to access those goods that you're producing. And on the third hand is a biological and a social precarity. In earlier times, which were happier times or more stable times, the presents were turbulent, but the futures were imaginable. From where we have reached a point where we have uncertain presents and unimaginable futures. It's when that particular kind of thing comes in that you actually have a crisis that produces a paradigm shift. If the digital's done something, I think that it is introducing this three-pronged crisis where none of the actors can mitigate the futures of the others. And so you see suddenly a new way by which people come onto the streets, people take things in their hand and saying, I don't know who I am, so I don't know what I can become, and now I need to find out. And that might be one of the ways of thinking about what's happening with the whole, almost a global revolution in people coming to the streets and saying, what do I do tomorrow and who am I going to be tomorrow?
For Marxism, society as a totality makes thinking about the individual superfluous because the individual is just a product of the bourgeois ideology of the individual. Individuals don't really exist. Society, the totality, the Hegelian totality, does exist. Think of a community in a small town or a tightly knit community in an ethnic neighborhood. A tightly knit community is by definition one in which everybody knows everybody else. The friends of your friends know the friends of my friends who know the friends of her friends. When everybody knows everybody else, hearsay, gossip, travels really, really fast, particularly when it concerns a violation of a local norm, an unfulfilled promise, an unreciprocated favor, an unpaid bet, a lie. The moment you do one of those, right, everybody knows the following day. The community as a whole acts as a kind of reservoir for reputations. Because even if not everybody remembers that you lied or that you did not pay the bet or that you did not reciprocate the favor, enough people remember. If you live in a community where you live next to your neighbors and you make a living thanks to other people in the community, all your connections are in the community, you care about your reputation, and you care about the fact that your children are being left behind their backs or your wife is being ostracized, right? So ridicule and ostracism are emergent capacities of the community as a whole. That means that the community as a whole can act as an enforcement mechanism and as a reputation storage mechanism. As long as there's a critical mass of members that does the punishment and the remembering, it doesn't really matter what their personal identities are. They're emergent properties of the community, which means that the community cannot be reduced to its members.
As individuals, we don't actually have political power. We have to be small groups that can go to a community board, go to a local councillor. It really requires each one of us to take a stake, to claim an area, and to change something. And that's how it aggregates into a massive change.
The only possibility for democracy and agency seems to be that people understand how to program the world they're in. It's the question of literacy. Back down to John Dewey. We got speech, and we didn't just learn how to listen, we learned how to speak. Yeah. You know, you get text, you don't just learn how to read, you learn how to write. You know, now we have computers, you shouldn't just learn how to use them, we need to know how to program them if we want to participate.
Very different actors with very different projects use the same properties to produce extremely different outcomes. If we think of interactive domains, in other words, domains where a sociality is produced, something is made on space. It's not just a data pipeline where stuff just runs through. In the case of finance, it uses the decentralized access that activist organizations also went, so you welcome the openness. In only in the case of the activists, the civic activists, it is, yes, come, let's join, and you're all welcome, we can all come in. In the case of finances, yes, give me your money, all around the world, give me your money. That's the openness. And then through interactivities and simultaneous, you know, connectivity and blah, blah, there are multiplier effects. In the case of civil society, it has to do with producing a subjectivity that is part of the activism, so that you don't need to be talking to each other. It doesn't depend on communication, nor does it only exist when you're actually online talking. On the contrary, it's a subjectivity that even people then who have zero access to the technology can partake in. That is the power, that there is a broader realm that is produced. These technologies enable something that goes beyond the actual technical properties that the engineer designed.
If you have a cause you care about, you can make a difference without even leaving the couch.
What political movements are essentially kind of lamenting about is the fact that people are only becoming clicktivists or slacktivists. Like, I will click on how much I like Occupy Wall Street, but I don't want to leave the comfort of my home to go there. And that is a slightly new phenomenon when you look at historically how political activism has happened. That if you think of yourself as political, you needed to be physically and biologically present at the moment of the political manifestation. One of my friends has a really interesting project where she scrapes hashtags from Twitter in Tunisia when the Tunisian revolution was happening. And within Tunisia, only 12% of the people, of all the Twitter users, were actually talking about things like revolution, overthrow, democracy, and so on. It was largely Americans who were talking about it on Twitter and attributing it to that. Now, who was politically present at the Tunisian revolution becomes an important question. Was it these people who were biologically present but not politically affiliated? Or these people who were virtually present and politically affiliated? And that's going to lead to really strange questions about what constitutes politics.
The question is, do we want to participate, or was Dewey wrong?
Part of the political and conceptual challenge I think we're facing today in this new global order is how to construct powerful political subjects. This perspective also has to do with recognition of ourselves as individuals, and that we recognize ourselves as individuals in a relationship of power. The claim is, or the received knowledge is, or what we assumed was, and many will still claim, is that only if you have a unified agenda, a centralized leadership, a centralized organization, can you be effective. And I think instead, I think in fact that's not true. I think that today, increasingly, the opposite is becoming true. Only by being organized in network form, only by that organization of multiplicity, can you actually both, it can be effective, overthrow forms of power.
David Harvey, the neo-Marxist geographer, said that capitalism needs to grow at 3% a year. And everything that we witness, every piece of turmoil that we're part of, is part of that reconstruction of the world to keep growing at 3% a year. I mean, what he called the spatial fix. And so, yeah, I mean, there's a spatial fix and there's a societal fix, perhaps, that we have to keep dismantling to keep that growing at 3% a year. You know, we basically are dismantling, to some extent, a leftist state, you know, the notion of the welfare net, because we believe not only in the market's ability to do good, I mean, that's been described, but, like, we basically need to feed the market. We basically need to privatize it. We basically need to put that money into it, or at least that's the assumption. I just think of those giant pools of capital racking up. The system breaks down if it doesn't invest 3% a year. Then you reach the trap we're in now, where you have labor that can't work and you have capital that can't be invested. We have a mismatch in both. So we're in a trap. We're in a trap where we have labor and capital that can't both be utilized. And there's no perfect match between them, so they can't be efficiently used. So they just sort of stagnate. They're both stagnant right now, searching for ways to get going again. Singapore is a developed nation, it's a highly educated nation, but it's still sort of an autocratic nanny state. And they wouldn't have it any other way. And they have one of the highest per capita incomes in the world. If I've ever asked whether the people of the U.S. would make an overt bargain, literally an overt bargain, that we'd be willing to live under a totalitarian autocracy as long as our standard of living is high and improving, I have no doubt that we would do it, because you can see the Chinese people have done exactly that. I mean, they have no illusions over what system they're in, ultimately, but they're extremely nationalist and they're willing to make this grand bargain. And that, to me, was frightening.
It seems to me that the last 20 years are yet another exhibit that liberal democracy is not functioning. It is producing more inequality, producing more poverty, incredible concentrations of wealth. So to me, those are sort of some of the key elements in this notion that liberal democracy is one of those formalized systems of power that is going to end.
How is it that human intention actually constructs alternative realities that have physical import? That's a different way of thinking about things. I mean, when you think you have a complete answer, you're in trouble. So ambiguity is good rather than certitude, because a certitude is a form of self-deception, I think. So there's a very different set of premises that go, and things are interconnected. They're not compartmentalized. Not everything's fungible.
Just the despot king who has power. It is the kid who programs on trading platforms in Citibank that can take down a really large bank or even a national economy. It is the scientist who's building the vaccines who may choose to use that for something else. It is a series of people who have enormous accumulated power.
Failure's overrated. In order for a society to learn, to evolve an ecosystem in which success is rewarded and becomes self-fulfilling, it generates more success, failure has to be tolerated at the societal level. It has to be facilitated, because you have to get rid of the scrap quickly and efficiently. You have to be able to terminate. It's very Darwinistic, if you will. The faster and more efficient that process is, the better it is. That only happens if failure is structurally possible and culturally possible. There are a lot of societies in which that's not the case. So at the individual level, you should hate failure. At the societal level, you should allow it and make it easy. I think blaming people for being overly creative is hypocritical and self-destructive. We have to regulate it effectively. The problem is the complexity outstrips our ability to regulate it. So what are you telling people? Don't be complex. Don't invent that microprocessor because we don't understand it. Don't invent the new drug because we don't understand it. No. You cannot tell people to do things that are not in their self-interest. The purpose of regulation is to tweak their self-interest so that it's more aligned with the interest of society. That's what regulation does.
There's some really interesting questions as to what happens and in which direction do we evolve and how do we co-evolve? How we coexist with various people, because the amount of destructive power in various people's hands, whether it be a computer virus, whether it be a financial issue, whether it be a weapon of mass destruction, we have to treat each other as communities in better ways so that people don't opt out of this system that we're building because they feel that the deck is stacked against them, they'll never have a chance, they'll never catch up. You know, it goes against some of their basic ethics. I mean, it pays to educate women. It pays to put schooling behind people. It pays to put vaccination behind people. It pays to open up systems to the point where people can see a way for a better life for them and their kids, because otherwise they're not going to have a stake in keeping the existing system up, running, and getting better.
Some of the things that are happening now, like the atomization of subjectivity, our dispersal into a world of network flows, the end of a dominant public, even the end of a linear idea of time, these are cultural frameworks that emerged at a certain point in time. They emerged roughly with the Enlightenment. And the fact that they're going away isn't necessarily something to just lament. It's something to say, okay, this happened in the Enlightenment. It happened very fast that we came up with modern subjectivity, that we came up with a novel, that we came up with the art market, that we came up with the public, with an idea of media. All these things emerged in the space of a few decades. And we're now seeing the end of these, again, in the space of a couple of decades. And in a longer historical framework, we need to understand these are not eternal truths. These are historically contingent frameworks that now are going away.
I think it is facing a younger generation even more than it was to recognize the powers we have. And that in that sense, yeah, I wouldn't call it optimism, because I think optimism often means like pretending things are going to be better when you really have no reason for it. It's rather recognizing that we do have power, you know, that we do have power to change the world. And sometimes that comes through an historical recognition, like to recognize that forces of resistance and freedom came before power historically. We can see that, well, today we have that power too. And even though it so often seems as if the forces of domination are so stacked against us, they're really to try to discover the ways in which we really do. That we really are the forces of innovation, like that we are really the forces that that create the new, and therefore can once again change the world.
I think people need to give up on big branded movements where they get credit. There's this sort of 20th century thing, and it was great. Martin Luther King in the street, arm in arm with the rabbis, and we're going to go and we're going to win. Eyes on the prize, make the thing. And I mean, that's the narrative arc of a great traditional book movement, you know, and they lead to this kind of ends justify the means ideological nightmares when they go the wrong way. I think we're in a different place now. I feel like the real enemy is not just, you know, the corporation, but are these giant abstract models that people have mistaken for the commons or for reality.
What's changed is using the interactive toys, not for interaction per se, but to restructure participation, to change who can participate in this political process, to change who has evidence, to change the structure of participation. And I think that's what these new technologies give us the opportunity to do. And frankly, if we can draw on the intelligent interpretation of many people, you know, that's our biggest resource. That's the capacity we have. That's what a participatory democracy is based on, the assumption that each one of us has something to say and interpret.
It's important to think of love as a political concept in some ways that we've lost. What do I mean by political concept? Not just a question of the couple and the family, and not also just a question of love of the nation, but rather a way of naming a politics of constructing community. It's not that love would create a whole or create make us all same or unify, but love would be that social bond of our differences.
We were talking about technology in general and the effects it's likely to have on society and the problems related to technological transplanting of technology into underdeveloped countries. In regard to this problem of the ultimate revolution,
we mustn't be caught by surprise by our own advancing technology. This has happened again and again in history. Technology has advanced, and this changes social conditions, and suddenly people have found themselves in a situation which they didn't foresee and doing all sorts of things they didn't really want to do.
Making the world. We all have the possibility to make every step forward is the making of a new world. The world is not in front of us. The world is the world that we make together every moment, in a sense. And that's the exciting part. I think today that the film can be put forward as a conversation that engages others, and together, in a sense, we make something even more than the film. And the thinkers and the people in the film are just a catalyst for ourselves to kind of engage in further action, further conversation.